Hey guys, and welcome back to another Lost Bits video right here on TetraBitGaming, the series where we explore the unused, altered, and unseen content in gaming. After several years, the long-awaited sequel to Hello Neighbor that I believe MatPadGT is going to enjoy is finally here. Now, we won't be diving into the sequel just yet, and not even into the final version of the original game, as first I want to dive into some pre-release alpha and beta builds of Hello Neighbor where numerous changes can be found. In fact, I recently learned there's like a whole separate sect of the Hello Neighbor fanbase that wholeheartedly prefer the alphas and betas to the final version. But yeah, I haven't ever covered this series on Lost Bits yet, so I do hope you enjoy. Anyways, with all that said, break open that like button. It's time to check out some Hello Neighbor alpha and beta Lost Bits. Alright, so to kick things off here, before we get to the alpha builds themselves, there's a whole bunch of early concept art for the game that was shared with the public, namely in the Hello Neighbor Exposed art book that shows off the neighbor, or Theodore, in just his gloves. Anyways, in addition to a whole bunch of concept art for items and objects and such, there are a few that show off several changes compared to the final game that I wanted to focus on here. Most importantly, I think, a few images were shared giving us insight into what Theodore was originally going to look like before his final design was chosen. This here is apparently the first sketch of Theodore that was ever made. Here is the first model of his head that was made from plasticine from late 2014, and then here is the first ever 3D model of Theodore that was made. Yeah, although his head and face stayed relatively similar, the rest of Theodore definitely underwent several changes. Then, seemingly the next design iteration can be seen on this concept art of Theodore boarding up the basement where he's seen in a different yellow shirt and green vest, and his hairstyle is a bit different as well. This is also similar to another sketch where he is again seen in some different clothes and his hair is once again in a different style. Now, eventually the final clothing and hairstyle was chosen, but there was one really important last choice to make. What kind of mustache should the neighbor have? For this, the developers shared a video showing off all of the other mustache styles that were being considered, including one shared by at least two famous 20th century people. Yeah, I'm assuming this one was a joke. Then next, we got a few concept sketches for the game's protagonist that we play as, Nikki. Here we can see some different outfits and hairstyles that were being considered, as well as various facial expressions. Then, other notable early concept sketches include some for places in the neighbor's home, some bagged items, early concept art for the mannequins, including this set in both a male and female design. There's a few early bow designs, conceptual art for the game's gramophone and apple gun, as well as the neighbor's house itself. But quite possibly the most bizarre pre-release sketch from the game comes from Hello Neighbor's Kickstarter page. Anyways, there's a whole bunch more cool concept sketches that, in the interest of time, I won't be diving into here, but if you'd like to check them all out, as always, head on over to the Cutting Room Floor page, which I'll have linked for you in the description below. And on that note, let's now finally get to talking about Hello Neighbor's pre-release builds and discuss several changes and unused bits of content. First up, we have the pre-alpha build of the game, which is currently the earliest known publicly available build of Hello Neighbor. For starters, we have the original model of the neighbor's house. This is apparently the model of the house that was used in the announcement trailer for this game, and I guess it was so early that it was even updated for the pre-alpha release. Either way, yeah, left over are the first floor section, as well as the upper second floor. Then next, there are several unused stock voice lines for the neighbor dropping some fat cuss words at the player if he caught you breaking into his house or smashing a window. And now, moving on to the proper alpha phase of this game's development, we start with Alpha 1. And first up here are a pair of unused blueprints for some objects in the game. The first of these is for a fork. Now, unfortunately, not much is really known about its purpose, but based on the name, I reckon it would function as, well, a fork. And then the second unused blueprint is listed as car drive, and it functions exactly as you might expect. As seen in this footage, it appears that there was once at least some intention to be able to drive a car in this game, as there's leftover functionality for it. Now yeah, it definitely looks pretty scuffed, but honestly this seems like it could have made for a fun idea in this game. And lastly, for this first alpha, there are a few models that go unused. First, there are two unused models left over for a level 2 in the rifle range that was never implemented. The first of these is a mirror object that appears to be complete, and then secondly is an object simply known as Pride. The Pride object lacks a proper texture, but for both of these, based on their name and where they're found, it appears that they would have been new target types introduced on the range at a second level that was never added. Then next, there are a pair of models for items that never made it into this alpha build. We got this untextured model of a saw, as well as this textured slingshot that was presumably going to be usable as a weapon in the game, much like the rifle. Interestingly, although a slingshot never ended up making it in Hello Neighbor, a slingshot did find its way into the alpha build of the Secret Neighbor multiplayer spin-off game, again, as a placeholder. Alright, now moving on to alpha number 2, first there are several more unused models left over in the game. We got this bottle of glue, a rocking chair, tumbleweed, 5 unique photos, a red chair, as well as a red chair, but broke. Furthermore, there are also a pair of unused items that, although they don't function as they should, we have a pretty good idea how they were supposed to work. The first of these is a large stereo system that can be used to bait Theodore into investigating it if you turn it on. And then secondly is a spider item that here defaults to spawning in as a banana for some reason. Although it doesn't fully function as intended here, apparently this spider was going to hiss at the player when picked up, and then this hiss would alert Theodore to your position. Needless to say, this isn't something you'd want to pick up in the game. Then next, there's an unused set of animations for the neighbor as well as his front doors where he would have been seen slamming them shut. This was apparently intended to be an animation that was going to be used after Theodore catches the player and then boots him out, but instead, in this build, you just respawn outside with the door already closed. Alpha 2 here also has an unused icon texture for the Sharkotron, which, although absent in this alpha, was seen patrolling the flooded room on the second floor in Alpha 1. Although it can't normally be picked up, the existence of this graphic as an item icon strongly suggests that there was a plan for the Sharkatron to be a grabbable item. And next up for Alpha 2 here, and probably the most interesting thing left over in my opinion, is Neighbor 3, a normally unused test map. This large building features a whole bunch of areas used to test various aspects of the game, from platforming to a simple setup testing using the key and keycard, to some other stuff like the pop gun here, which is found all the way on the top floor. Being a developer test room, it shouldn't be surprising that things are pretty unpolished here. From messed up doors, to objects clipping out of walls and floors, to a duplicate neighbor model just chilling here, floating sideways. Nice. The layout of this area, especially the main room here, strongly resembles the area that's seen in the ending of the final game, so it's possible that this test area was at least somewhat repurposed for that section too. Although unfortunately, Theodore still chases you around here, which can be annoying if you're just trying to explore and such, but if you disable him with some cheats, it's honestly really fun to just walk around the area and mess around with the various objects found within. If you've been around this channel for a while, you know I love me my test room, so you can imagine how happy I was to see one here, especially one this big and robust. Now actually, before we move on to the next prototype build of this game, there are actually quite a few interesting things found normally unseen, either out of bounds or out of normal view. For starters, there are several things found just under the floor, many of which are leftovers from Alpha 1. These include Nikki's entire car, a duplicate of the red key to his house from Alpha 1, found just under the road here is a hammer, and there's also the original copper key from Alpha 1 found under the neighbor's house here. Then we also got a whole bunch of other duplicated stuff found under Theo's house, including a duplicate of the locked door, a jug of milk, the front doors, a mannequin and coat rack, not one but two of these wardrobes, and finally a duplicate of both Theodore and Nikki as well. Now these last two seem to be tied to how the characters respawn, as their underground location appears to change depending on where their above ground counterparts are when the map is loaded and reloaded. There's also an alternate door found under the locked one to the basement, as well as a wooden slab under the moving wall hiding the stairs going to the second floor. Since both of these are found right under a corresponding object, I reckon these are early placeholder versions that were used for each of these. And finally, the last thing I want to cover for Alpha 2 is found down in the basement area. So normally, when you reach this door in the child's room in the basement, the game will instantly end, pointing you to the game's website, despite you being able to see that there's more behind the crack in the doorway. Well, there actually is more to this basement, a lot more, and this was even seen in the trailer for this build, so I'm sure fans were confused to see that this alpha ended abruptly this way the first time playing through it. But yeah, behind this door are several winding hallways and splitting paths, which all really end up taking you to the same areas, then ultimately leading to this room and door here, which I assume was going to be the end. It's pretty crazy, as comparing this to what's normally played in this build, this is quite a bit of content they decided not to use. Also, a few ideas like using a generator to open up a gate seem to have been reworked into the final game's Chapter 2. It seems strange that the developers showcased footage from this area in their trailer and then completely cut it from the release, but I guess maybe they just didn't deem it ready for public play. Next, on to Alpha 3 we go, where first off, not only does the Neighbor 3 test map return, but the Alpha 2 stage is still also found kicking around in the files and can even be loaded into here. The area appears to be more or less the same as seen in Alpha 2, but lacking objects such as a few doors and such, but yeah, overall it's pretty much the same experience. Interestingly, if the neighbor catches you here though, instead of booting you back outside, you are taken right to the basement area. There are actually a handful of other normally unused areas in this build too, the first of which is an area known simply as Basement. Now, despite the name, there's not really anything basement-y about this map. Pretty much all it is an open field with a large bucket seated in the middle. Is there anything in the bucket though, you might be wondering? How do I put this? No. Strangely, you can actually pick this bucket up, though unfortunately it returns down to normal size. One super weird quirk about this map though is that if you stand around for too long, a strange shine overlay will start to slowly appear on screen, and then after a while your eyes will seemingly close and you will hear the sound as if you were captured by the neighbor and the map resets. It's pretty strange. I guess based on the name and effect of slowly seeing stars and then seemingly passing out, this may have been a test for a scrapped effect of the player suffocating or something in the basement. Then next up, we got early versions of two of the fear levels seen in the final game, Fear School and Fear Darkness. For Fear Darkness, it actually seems relatively close to how it's seen in the final version, though the toaster is pretty scuffed here, and it's only really complete up until this section where a power switch was eventually implemented. So yeah, without cheats, this is basically as far as you can go. The upper areas are still modeled though, and if we take the camera outside, we can see that although the inside looked pretty good, the outside is pretty unfinished, which yeah, makes sense. The typical player wasn't meant to ever see this. Now, while Fear Darkness seems well along, the same can't be said for the other unused fear map here, Fear School. Here we spawn in a long hallway with a few desks, and instead of the mannequins, we have clones of Nikki as placeholders. The idea for this area is basically the same as seen in the final, with the AI chasing you down when the bell rings. This version is pretty difficult to play though, as without any of the lockers to hide in as seen in the final, and the desks not really working, there's not really anywhere to hide from the AI fellas, but thankfully it seems like you do run faster than them, so you can just keep your distance. And in addition to this main hallway, there's also this side area behind this door. There's not really too much else here, but this isn't something seen in the final version of the school, so I wonder if there was once planned to expand on this zone. Then next, Alpha 3 also has a lone unused audio track, and it's an early version of the intro theme. It's really basic, featuring only a single instrument. Here's a quick sample. Now Now, there certainly aren't as many objects found out of bounds in Alpha 3 here, if any, but by zipping the camera where we normally shouldn't, we can take a look at the higher levels of the neighbor's place to see a few areas that don't look quite finished. Areas lacking textures, cables that lead to nothing, doors that lead to empty areas, unfinished elevators, a flooded room, and more. Definitely seems like there are bits and pieces here of ideas that never got implemented in time for this alpha's release, but I'm pretty sure most, if not all of these, were eventually implemented in the next build. And lastly, for Alpha 3, although not technically unused, with the game's darkness and fog, I don't believe this is ever visible from the normal play area, but if we take the camera closer to the school, we can see that here it's called the Alpha 3 High School. A pretty neat little secret that I don't think many, if any, saw when playing this game normally. Then next and last for the Alpha builds is Alpha 4, and here, let's start things off with some unused audio. First up are a bunch of sound effects intended to have been used for the Fear School section of the game. We got the sounds of kids whispering, which is different than the whispering that's normally heard. Then there's also a sound effect of kids laughing, as well as some generic school ambiance listed as school, recreation, or recreation. Now, individually, these audio bits aren't anything too crazy, but in the context of being heard in a creepy school nightmare, yeah, it's pretty unsettling. Then secondly, and similarly, there are a handful of unused sound effects for the also-scrapped Fear Factory level. These include more whispering, a pair of scrapped metal creaking sounds, as well as some more general ambient noises for this area. Now for those that don't know, like I mentioned earlier, the Fear Factory was another Fear stage that was once planned to be featured in the game, but never ended up getting fully realized. And although the loading trigger for it is already there in Alpha 4 in the normally inaccessible flooded room that I mentioned earlier, it just kicks you out back to the same room here, and it wasn't until later beta builds where it was actually made playable from this area. Fear Factory was pretty similar to Fear School in the fact that as soon as you start in, numerous mannequins will be around you and will rush towards you. Instead of instantly killing you though, they will just swarm around you and you will see a basketball on the floor. The player would then have to throw this basketball and essentially play fetch with all the mannequins, and you could only move when they are chasing the ball. Completing this Fear section of the game was going to award the player with the Super Throw ability, but since apparently this section wasn't deemed fun enough and too difficult to complete by the developers, it was scrapped. And instead, the Super Throw is just a default ability that the player starts with. But yeah, following the supermarket and school, it looks like the plan initially might have been to feature sections from each of the major buildings seen in the main map far away from the player's view, as we can see those, as well as the factory here and hospital, which was also another Fear level that was cut and just replaced with a cutscene. Then moving on to some unused 3D models, there are several seemingly placeholder ones that were added related to the game's final battle against the Thing. We got a bottle, a bow, a firework rocket, as well as an early blocky test version of the Thing itself. Next up, there's a single normally unplayable level in Alpha 4 titled Golden Apple. Now this is actually the area that you are briefly taken to when doing the secret Golden Apple side mission in the game. The cutscene is very short, so you don't get to appreciate the area as much normally, but let's check it out here. Now this area appears to be a fake prop room, as is seen in the full game's second chapter, but here instead we just have a T-posing Theodore asserting his dominance, as well as a pulsing Thing at the doorway. But this isn't the only instance of this map, as for this one, the lighting isn't quite finished, as if you're here normally without disabling lighting, things are very dark and hard to see. But interestingly, this same area can be actually found under the normal main map in this block, where here the lighting is much better. In any case though, a pretty cool behind the scenes look into how the Golden Apple cutscene was made. And there are actually a few more cool things to check out that are found beneath the map, and firstly, there's this large blocky apparatus that's apparently a prototype version of the Golden Apple Tree, as it was visible in its place in an early video for this build. There's also this large untextured platform, a copy of the letter that the player receives at the apartment at the start of this build, and then far off near the pond area we can find that a Sharkotron can be seen here. A nice little Easter egg to remember Alpha 1. Next, I found at least two different placeholders for the thing that I don't think are normally visible. The first of these is found up on the beams in the Fear School section. It's normally so dark here that even if you know where to look, I don't think you'd be able to see this fella at all. And secondly, there's one normally seen at the exit door in the basement section. Again, I don't think he's all too visible from a distance when you can first see this door by this block section, and by the time you get to the door normally, he's long gone. In fact, it looks like it's only visible if I spawn in the map near the door, as if I walk too far away, it despawns, and it doesn't reappear if I get closer. It's really weird, and yeah, just in general, this early version of the thing is pretty strange. Oh, and I didn't mention it earlier, but actually in Alpha 3, there's another one of these chumbos hiding around. In the end of Alpha 3, you come across Theodore crying in this room, and behind this door that's normally locked and inaccessible, yep, the 2D thing can be found here, only visible from one direction. And last up for Alpha 4, there are a few models left over in the files that appear to be early versions of the Fear School level. They're not all too different, as all of these models appear to be very similar to the final design of the area. Now finally, moving on to the beta builds of Hello Neighbor, there isn't as much to talk about as with the alphas, but there's still a few neat little things. Firstly, for Beta 1, the prototype Golden Apple Tree is still here under the map, as is the Golden Apple Room. The Golden Apple Easter egg was removed from this beta, as far as I know, so it's interesting to see this still kicking around here. And just like the other stuff, the platform and letter from the apartment section are also still here, and this time around, the apartment area is actually playable in this beta. And then, speaking of the apartment, if we take the camera outside of it, we can have a nice look and see just how unfinished most of the city here looks out of view. And furthermore, just above the player's apartment is a floating area where inside are two different rooms. One with a door and a bunch of stuff, as well as this other one with Theodore and a boarded up door. Much like the Golden Apple Room, it appears that this room is what's used for the intro animation section at the start of this build. Pretty cool. Then skipping to Beta 3, once again the prototype and Golden Apple Room are found under the map, but this time with some changes. The prototype tree appears to have lost its branches and is now just a single pole thing. And then the Golden Apple Room is no longer encased in a box and is just chillin' here in the open. And interestingly enough, it looks like there may have been some intention to bring this little secret back to the game. Added in Beta 3 is this room, which normally just has some cake on the floor, as well as this sign, which you may remember from Alpha 4, near the gramophone where you bring the Golden Apple to trigger the secret cutscene. Well, there's no gramophone here this time, right? Wrong, as just behind this wall here, it can be found hanging upside down. Now that's fine and all, but some players were still able to activate this gramophone through the wall with a Golden Apple, and it still takes you to that same secret room. But since it isn't enclosed this time, we can see just how scuffed everything looks outside from here. Now, based on the sign and gramophone being found here so close together in this room and still fully functional, I want to believe that yeah, the developers might have at least considered to add this Easter egg back in the game in some shape or form. And one more thing that I noticed was added far away from the normal play area in Beta 3 was this pizza delivery car that has seemingly swerved off the road and crashed into the pond here. I guess you could say the driver really took the L on that one. Now the last thing I want to touch on for the betas is actually an alternate ending that seems to show off a different story dynamic between the player and Theodore compared to what's seen in the final version. In this beta ending, instead of seeing a young Nikki playing with toys, here we see Theodore. And instead of just getting scared and running up the stairs, Theodore here prances over to this wardrobe and knocks over the vase on the top. This then prompts him to run over to the window to see the big thing, and then from this point you actually defend Theodore from it. Now apparently, up until and including Beta 3 here, Nikki was actually Theodore's son, and not just some random neighbor that happened to catch him keeping his son in the basement, as is the case in the final version. And this is heavily reinforced by one of the achievements you get in the final game for completing it called Like Father, Like Son. So yeah, apparently there was once going to be a bigger focus on the father and son relationship and I guess trying to mend it, as opposed to overcoming Nikki's own trauma from the neighbor instead. It's quite a big shift in narrative, and based on the devs not even changing the name of that one achievement, I reckon this might have been a change made quite late into the final game's development. Say what you will about this game and how jank it may be, but honestly, I think it's really cool not only that the developers released this game in so many alpha and beta stages, but it's extra cool of them to keep all of these pre-release builds easily accessible on Steam. And I think it's really cool to see just how much this game has evolved over time, from its early pre-alpha stages to the final product. But I think we'll leave it on that note for now. Like I said at the start, this is my first time covering the series on Lost Bits, so I have no idea how much interest there is for this game's unused content on this channel, so if you did enjoy and would like to see me cover the full game and maybe Hello Neighbor 2 someday, please do let me know with a like and comment below. And while you're here, check out my speedrun video on this game, and be sure to subscribe to find your way back here in the future. And as always, thank you all so much for stopping by today, and I will see you in a bit.